This video is sponsored by LoomCube Panel Pro, portable, powerful, and precise. In this video, we're going to be taking a look at the iPhone 12 Pro Max, which is the latest flagship from Apple. We're going to be taking a look at this mainly from a photography perspective, but I do want to look at the phone as a whole. Now, I will be honest, I used to be the kind of person who did not upgrade my phone every year, and that has kind of changed recently due to a few things. So, first of all, cameras have gotten much more advanced in smartphones from every manufacturer in the last 2 years, and also because I cover phones on this channel, I figured it would probably be worth it for me to go ahead and upgrade my iPhone. So it arrived last Friday. I wasn't sure really what to expect in terms of hardware. There didn't seem like it was a massive upgrade, but my God, am I surprised. There is a lot to cover in this video, so I will index it in the show description in case you need to bounce around to a specific section. So the big new feature in iPhone 12 Pro phones is 5G compatibility. And now I'm going to admit that I live in Fort Worth, Texas, so it's not that big a town. And for me, we got 5G. If you go downtown, it's not really available. Outside of that, it's very spotty, and even downtown, I don't know that it's that much of a bump from LTE. So your mileage is going to vary depending on where you live and where you're using the device. So 5G, at least from my experience in the year 2020, is not the amazing experience that it kind of claims that it's going to be. However, the imaging functionality on this phone is amazing. So photography, video, this is where it's really going to shine. So is it worth the upgrade to go with something like the iPhone 12 Pro Max? I also want to be clear that I am talking about the Pro Max version of this phone. So there are some big differences between iPhone 12 Pro Max and just the regular iPhone 12 Pro. A lot of that has to do with the size. There's some things that we've got room for in terms of lens elements and sensor shift, and I'm going to get into all those. But just note that they're not the same phone. So I guess another question, is it worth upgrading and spending the money to get the bigger phone? So this is a photography channel, and I'm obviously going to be addressing this mainly from a photography standpoint, but it's also worth noting this phone is brand new. I just got this less than a week ago, and I was very early to order it. We are still waiting on one of the key features that I think is going to put this over the top. In terms of still photography, it's going to make it the king of any smartphone. Talking, of course, about Apple ProRaw, which is going to be a format that allows you to capture raw DNG files on this phone, but they're not what you would expect out of a typical DNG file. So this update is coming this year. It's going to be in iOS 14.3. We're on 14.2 now. I know the developer beta is out. It is coming soon, and I will readdress this and come back to it when that version is out so we can test out the ProRaw. So I'll do a whole dedicated video on that later, but why am I excited about this, and what is ProRaw? So up till now, iPhones natively capture images in one of two formats, either JPEG or HEIC, which is a high efficiency format. What happens is when you take the photo, the phone actually possibly takes multiple photos that you don't even notice. It just happens fast. There's no shutter lag thanks to the new chip. And what it does is it actually runs those through a series of algorithms for computational imaging. And so with the iPhone, this includes things like smart HDR, includes things like deep fusion, or if you're working in night mode. What it does is it processes these and it makes decision based on those. And it takes all this and it writes it to the JPEG or the HEIC file. Now, both of these formats are great because they're super easy to share. They're smaller file sizes. However, you don't have access to a lot of data. So if you're going to edit your images, you're going to find limitations in terms of the dynamic range that you're able to adjust in particular, but also color information. So this is why a lot of photographers who take this really seriously like to shoot in a raw format, because it ends up just giving you the raw data and then you can manipulate that in the editor of your choice. Now, Apple has had raw support on iPhones before, but not in the native camera app. It has to be accessed with a third-party app, something like Lightroom Camera, for example. And so what you're able to do is just get a raw image mainly from the main camera. It's been a little bit of a frustrating experience. Plus, you don't have access to any of the computational imaging that Apple provides for that HEIC or JPEG file. Well, guess what, folks? This is all about to change with Apple ProRaw. So Apple ProRaw is going to work on all four cameras, so the three rear cameras and then the front-facing selfie camera. And so this is going to save it in a format that will give you access to making editing choices with things that deep fusion or smart HDR or even night mode are doing. So theoretically, this will give you control over contrast. It will give you control over dynamic range. You'll be able to bring back highlights, hopefully rescue shadows, color information, as well well as image segmentation, where the camera actually takes parts of the image and segments it out to identifying, well, this is a skin tone or this is a sky. This could be really interesting. You will be able to edit these files natively on the phone in either the Photos app, and then also Apple is going to make it available for third parties as well. So as soon as we have support in things like Adobe Lightroom or Capture One, you'll be able to access these files there as well. These files will be much larger, so instead of really small JPEG files, you'll have a 25 megabyte file, but I think it's really going to be worth it if you want to have editing control over your images in the end. So I think you can see why I am super excited about Apple ProRaw, and I will revisit that once it's available on the phone. However, there are some things that we can get into today that are equally impressive. One of them has to do with video when we're talking about Dolby Vision. I'll get into that in just a second, but let's dive down and see what some of the new features physically are on this phone. So the phone itself has had a complete redesign, and Apple has gone back to the design aesthetic that they used to use on iPhones with the steel edges. It's kind of a boxy feel. I really like it. I think it's super nice, and I like the new color scheme. There are four new colors that are available. I personally opted for Pacific Blue, and you can see that the surgical grade stainless steel on the edges is also in that Pacific Blue, and I think it's just a really gorgeous phone. Another thing that's worth noting is the screen now uses a glass that's fused with ceramic. So if you've ever dropped your phone and spidered the front glass, you know exactly what I'm talking about, and this will give you four times more protection against accidents like drops. We also have waterproof certification up to 6 meters, so this is a much tougher design than what we've seen in the past. There are some changes to the camera modules, and we also have the addition of a LiDAR sensor, which I'll get into in just a second, and the screen on this phone is super impressive. This is the Super Retina XDR display, which is going to go up to about 1200 nits, which is about 87% brighter than what we've seen on previous models. One thing that I want to point out in a lot of the B-roll that you're looking at is I've got a lot of stuff with moving light, and I have something really cool I want to share with you. This is the Loom Cube Panel Pro, which is a little LED panel that is pocket-sized. It's actually the same size. Well, it's the same width as the iPhone, and it's a little bit shorter, but it's a really portable light that you can just have with you if you just need an accent light or an ambient light or even a main light if you're shooting stills or video, and that's what I used for all of the B-roll shots where you see light moving across the iPhone. It also comes with a diffuser panel, so if you're shooting a person or yourself or something where you want a more diffuse light, that can be achieved by just clipping this onto the front of the light. So I'll give you an example. Let's say you want to film in some really cool ambient light. I shot this last night. Well, it's a little too dark to see my face unless you turn on the Loom Cube Panel Pro, which does an excellent job. This thing is really bright, I want to mention too. This night footage that you're looking at, this was shot at 10%. So this is way more light than anybody's ever going to need, and it's actually nice to have more than you need than not enough. The Panel Pro also features quarter-inch tripod mounts on three sides, so you've got a lot of versatility in terms of how you want to mount this. You can put it on a tripod, you could put it on a camera, or you could just hold it like I was in these examples. What's really cool is it has adjustable white balance with a CRI over 96, so it's pretty accurate. It features a built-in battery, so you charge the light with a standard USB-C cable, just like you'd find in the... But you can use a USB-C cable from any of your other devices. There's also a large redesigned display screen on the back that provides easy-to-read settings and controls. So you can operate this just from the light by using the toggle switch here to go up and down or the power button to scroll through the options. You long press the power to turn it on or off. But the coolest thing about this light is it is Bluetooth compatible, and you can download the app and use those together so you can control all the light settings just from the app. And that's a huge deal because it makes it really easy to use, especially if you have this mounted somewhere out of reach and you need to be able to control it remote. This light actually uses professional grade bicolor RGB light, so you can do hard colors as well. There's 360 color options, and you have built-in lighting effects, and I was playing around with those, so you can do things. So let's say you're doing an indie film and you need to have something ambient where you have a siren or a police car in the background. Well, you can use this light to do it. It also features things like a fire setting, which is kind of cool, as well as lightning effects. This is actually very useful, and I've had a lot of fun playing around with this. So the Loom Cube Panel Pro retails at $229.95 US, but they have a special launch offer that goes live today, which is the launch day, November 19th. And the special is you can get this for $199, but do note that the stock is limited. So once that stock is gone, Loom Cube Panel Pro is going to be available for back order at the regular price. But it is expected to ship the week of December 7th. So delivery on the first 5,000 units is guaranteed before the holidays. Worldwide shipping is available and free shipping in the US. So this is really cool. I highly recommend that you guys check it out. If you are interested in learning more, there is a link in the description below. And we give a special shout out and thanks to the awesome folks over at LoomCube for sponsoring this video. So a couple new features that are really nice to have. So first of all, if you look at the camera modules here, you're gonna notice you have the three lenses, you have your flash, and then you have a fourth kind of mystery lens here. That is actually the LiDAR sensor. What is LiDAR? So LiDAR is a technology where a signal bounces off of objects and returns distance information to the camera. This is really handy to have for AR applications. It also applies to photography because it can assist with autofocus, because the LiDAR is not dependent on light as much as a lens would be on adjusting for phase detection or contrast detection autofocus. So basically, you're going to get much better low light performance with autofocus, which is super handy. One feature that's specific to the Pro Max version of this phone is the main camera now uses a larger sensor. So what this means is you are going to also get better low light performance, more detail, less grain, and you're also going to get a larger depth of field. So I would not say that this is just the most amazing bokeh in the world. I think you're still going to want to use portrait mode if that's what you're interested in shooting, but it is kind of nice to have just a little bit different look, and there are some benefits to the larger sensor. We also have a larger aperture in the main camera. It's an f1.6 now. And speaking of lens upgrades, we now have 7 elements in the main lens, but I think the star of the show here is the ultra wide angle. Now, on the previous version, I have the iPhone 11 Pro Max. I did some ultra wide angle shooting with this, and it does a really good job. It does a nice job of balancing the image, correcting the distortion, but one thing you will notice, and this is just a trait of the lens, is if you look in the corners, it gets a little funky in terms of sharpness. This seems to have been corrected in the new phone, so when I do a review where I talk about the ProRaw format, I'll get more into that, but that's a huge upgrade for me, especially if you like to use the ultra wide angle lens. Another feature unique to the Pro Max version of this phone is we have sensor shift image stabilization. So because it's a bigger phone, we have room to do this now in the design. So this phone on the main camera features a sensor that actually moves with the gyroscope, and the phone is aware of where it is and where it's tilting. And so what this does is it gives you better low light performance for longer exposure shots. So if you have a little bit shaky, or you're shooting video, for instance, and you want to remove the shake, it does a little bit better job than optical image stabilization. Having said that though, Apple has always done a really good job with optical image stabilization. So I don't know if you're going to notice that big of a difference. It depends on the kind of shots that you take and the kind of work that you do, you may notice a difference. Now, I mentioned we have a bigger screen and actually the same size body, which is very cool, but it's also brighter. This is the Super Retina XDR display, 87% brighter at 1200 nits. So this actually brings me to my favorite feature of this phone, because the two work in tandem. So what does the screen have to do with the photography feature? Well, it's called Dolby Vision and it applies to video. To be non-technical about this, when I first got the phone and opened up the camera app, one thing that I noticed that particularly was striking is when you move from the photo mode to video mode, all of a sudden everything gets brighter, the colors become more rich, you have more dynamic range, and I thought, what is going on? Even like the low light performance, you don't have much grain if you're shooting in lower light. Everything looks gorgeous. So this is Dolby Vision. Dolby Vision is a new technology, so we're in a little bit of the Wild West, I think, because it's still early, but there's some really amazing things that you can do, and this is a huge game changer for the iPhone. This is only available on the iPhone. In fact, it's not even available on any other camera. This is exclusive to Apple right now, so you're not even going to find this on a proper camera such as a Sony, a Canon, or a Nikon, or whatever. So it's a really interesting technology, and I want to explain a little bit why I think that. So we have a much brighter display, and I mentioned earlier that this was measured in what we call nits. This is a 1200 nit display, and so nit is a way we measure light coming off a screen. The more light you have, the brighter it is. So if you think of 0 nits being pure black, and if you think of 1200 being pure white, if this is a wider range than you can get on another screen, let's say, then there are more capabilities that you can do with the way that video is displayed. So we work with what we call HDR, which stands for high dynamic range. Now, I don't want to lose people with an over-technical description of this, but there is a reason this is really important on this phone. So one of the quintessential problems since the beginning of broadcast video, even for television back in the old days, is the format that you're broadcasting to. So we have a color space, and if you use a color space that can't be displayed where the viewer is trying to watch it, then what happens is things get washed out, everything goes weird, it looks gross, it's not what you want. And so we have kind of a standardized color space, or an SDR, that we typically film in. This is Rec. 709 for those of you who are tech geeks. And so HDR is a way of giving more information information and more color, more gamut, more light that goes into that. So you get much more dynamic range. So you see details in the shadows, or you see details in the highlights where you wouldn't with a standard display. The problem is distribution. So if you film in HDR, you have to guarantee that the viewer on the other end, whether that's on television or whether that's on the internet, is going to be able to pick up that HDR signal. This is where Dolby Vision gets particularly interesting. Dolby Vision actually has data in the file on a frame-by-frame basis that gives information about how the video should be played back. So for instance, if you're on an older computer or you're on a device that does not support HDR, it's not going to recognize the file and it's going to just play back the standard dynamic range information. However, if something does recognize Dolby Vision, it will bump it up. So basically, either way, you're covered with Dolby Vision. So it's going to look normal on any device. And of course, if you're on a device that supports it, you're going to get a beautiful image in the end. So from a creator standpoint, this is actually really cool in two different ways. So for me personally, I don't film in HDR. I do everything in what we call Rec 709, which is a standard format. And so what's cool is I can actually bring in HDR footage from Dolby Vision, and I can use that in my standard file. Now, the cool thing about that is you bring in either a LUT or you can use the plugin that's in Final Cut. Final Cut will have full support with this and a version coming before the end of the year, but you'll be able to convert it down to SDR. Now, why would you want to convert it down and not just shoot in standard dynamic range? Well, the reason is because you're putting a LUT after a color grade, and you can rescue shadow information, or you can rescue highlights, and so it works kind of like the advantages that you get from a RAW file. This is not a RAW format, but you do have 10 bits of depth, so there's a lot that you can do and a lot of versatility that you can get out of this. And all the sample shots that I did with this, they were really fun to shoot because this was low light, and if I did this in standard resolution on a phone, you wouldn't get any of this clarity. In fact, you'd just get a lot of noise, and it just wouldn't look very good. So there's a lot of advantages to using this. This is something I'm going to be exploring a lot in the next couple weeks too. Like I said, this isn't available anywhere else right now, and this really is a game changer. And because I know somebody will mention it, Samsung with their Pro Video in their app with the Galaxy S20 Ultra 5G, let's say, they do have HDR built in. It's not Dolby Vision. And so again, the playback compatibility becomes an issue with that. And of course, once your video editor does support it, then you will be able to edit and deliver content in Dolby Vision. So this is a big game changer. So bottom line, I absolutely love this phone. This was actually a very difficult video to put together because there's so much to talk about in terms of the new technology that's in here. The hardware upgrades on their own might seem a little bit minimal, but I think what comes with the computational imaging under the hood, ProRaw support, Dolby Vision, I think it's really worth upgrading. And to be honest, I know that there's some differences between the iPhone 12 Pro and the Pro Max versions. I highly recommend that you go for the Pro Max. I know they're little differences, but I think they're really, really nice to have. So I would love to know what you guys think. I'll be doing some more videos on this on various features where I can expand on them down the line, but I wanted to give an initial review and impressions on this phone. So drop me a comment below. I want to know what you guys have to say. I'll see you guys in the next video. Until then, later.